All right, guys. So what I want to do to start us off is some extreme background. I want to situate us in time. And the reason I want to do that is because we live right now in a very weird moment. And by that, I don't mean COVID, though COVID is strange, but I mean this entire world, this civilization that we were born into, though it's effectively all we know, is actually a really weird moment in the history of our species and the history of the planet. Now, one of the most profound things that I've taken from studying evolutionary psychology and evolution more generally is the type of mindset shift that comes from thinking in terms of evolutionary timescales. So, one of the things that liberated Darwin in the mid-1800s to even think about the idea of evolution was new research that had come out in the late 1700s and early 1800s about how old the planet actually was. Prior to that time, people really thought that we're talking thousands of years, which sure is a long time, but it's nowhere near what the truth is, which is that the planet is actually 4.5 billion years old. Now, billion-year timescales are so unfathomably large that it's hard for our human minds to actually think about. It's just not on a human scale. So one of the ways to understand how long this planet has been around and how short the world has been like it is right now is to compare that 4.5 billion-year timescale to something which is more understandable to us, which is something that's more manageable. And so a device that's sometimes used is to condense, say, that 4 billion years into something that we understand, 24 hours. And so if we were to do this, we would say that, well, what happened 4.5 billion years ago when the Earth was formed, let's say that's the very beginning of today. And then around lunchtime, around noon, what we're talking about there is just over 2 billion years ago. And then midnight tonight, that's the present moment. And so we can see relative to each other when all the things which are important in the history of our species, when they particularly happened. So like I said, the Earth is formed 4.5 billion years ago. You have evolving atmosphere for the first big chunk of it, and you don't have life emerge until somewhere after 4 billion years ago. The most conservative estimate, that is an estimate in which there's no disputation about it, is that life emerged about as recently as 3.5 billion years ago. So the early risers among you, this is 5:30 in the morning. You're getting up, life is getting started. Now, scientists don't actually know how this process happened. Somehow, organic compounds transmuted into living creatures. We don't really understand how that happened. We just know that it did, and it happened sometime around then. But then, for a really long time, 12 hours, half the day in terms of our little 24-hour period, very little happened. All that was on the planet, there were living creatures, but they were simple bacteria. Now, one of the big things that did happen during that time is that through photosynthesis, the sun led some simple bacteria to start producing oxygen. And this happened in such large quantities for such a long time that it actually changed the amount of oxygen that was in the oceans and the atmosphere. But still, it wasn't until early evening that multicellular organisms even evolved. And it wasn't until right around 9 p.m. when you saw what's called the Cambrian explosion, where evolution really accelerated. And a lot of the animal body plans and plant body plans that we know now first emerged. So it was only after that, between 9 p.m. and 10 p.m. in our day, that you see such things as fish evolve and land plants. Trees didn't exist until then. You didn't see animals existing on land outside of the ocean until then. You see insects develop shortly after that. And then right around 11 p.m., just 1 hour before midnight, you see the dinosaurs emerge. And they existed for a long time. So 135 million years, which translates in our 24-hour day to about 40 minutes. They existed for a long time. And of course, then the asteroid that took them out 65 million years ago, or really just 20 minutes before midnight. Only after that, only after the dinosaurs were gone, did you see things like, well, first flowers emerging? Imagine that. Until 11:40 p.m., there were no flowers on this planet because there were no pollinating insects. And then primates. And then finally, just 4 seconds before midnight, you see us. All right, now I want to zoom in to those last 2 minutes of the day, because a lot of stuff happens then, right? So that represents 6 million years. 6 million years ago, something very important happened, which was that we shared a common ancestor with what is our now closest living relative on the planet, which is the chimpanzee. That's the last time we shared any common ancestor with any currently living creature. Now, it's important to know that that wasn't a chimpanzee itself. We didn't descend from chimpanzees. Chimpanzees are our cousins, not our uncles or parents. The ancestor that we both descended from looked, this is what their skull looked like. Looked like the skull on the left there, put next to a human skull on the right. Both chimpanzees and us have had 6 million years of evolution since then, and we've both undergone a lot of changes. One of the interesting changes that the chimpanzee underwent happened 2.5 million years ago, when the then ancestor, whatever the 2.5 million year ago proto-chimpanzee species was, that population got caught on either side of the Congolese River. So you had one group on one side, one group on the other side, and because they were separated by the river, they couldn't interact anymore. They didn't interact for thousands, millions of years. And in that time, they went along the slightly different evolutionary paths. So much so that they actually evolved, those two populations evolved into different species. One became the regular chimpanzee that we know, Pan Troglodytes, and the other became the bonobo chimpanzee, Pan Bonobo. Some of you guys have probably heard of those. That's how speciation happens, right? So there'll be one population, one species, that will be separated for long enough. They'll go along enough of a different evolutionary path that they become two different species. Now, that ultimately happened to ourselves as well, but I'll get into that a little later. Instead, let's look at what happened after we diverged from our common ancestor with the chimpanzees. The proto-human, the first one that kicked around for a very long time, for 2 million years, was the Australopithecus. So this is great-great-great, many great-grandpa. And the Australopithecus was the first of our ancestors to be entirely bipedal. You can see that chimpanzees can walk on two legs. That's what bipedal means. But they prefer not to. They prefer to trundle along using their arms as well, but the Australopithecus was fully bipedal. Now, why did bipedalism emerge? Why did it evolve? It offered many benefits. It kept us cool because we're further off what was a hot African savanna ground. It allowed us to gather things in our arms. It allowed us to see from a higher vantage point, see predators who might be out on the horizon. And eventually, importantly, critically, it allowed for tool use. Because we had extra limbs, we weren't just using all four limbs to just walk along. We just needed two limbs for that now, which means we had our hands free to use tools. And use tools we did, right? So the Australopithecus, though they didn't fashion special tools, they didn't manipulate existing rocks into new tool-shaped things. They did use found tools. They had a brain size that was about a third, a cranial size that's about a third of what ours is now. They were followed up by Homo habilis, the first of the Homo genus, which is the genus that we belong to, Homo sapiens, that's what we are. And Homo habilis, it means man, habilis means handy. It was handyman because this was the first creature to actually fashion their own complex tools like that. And they were able to do so because they had a pretty large brain, about half the size of our brain. Their skull sizes from the fossils we have can house a brain that's about half the size of the brain that our skulls can house. That was followed up by the next stage in human evolution, which is Homo erectus, upright man. Tools were even more complex, and brain size was even closer to approaching ours, so two-thirds of our brain size. Now, Homo erectus was also the first of our ancestors to move out of Africa. So all of this hitherto is happening on the continent of Africa. Homo erectus moves out of Africa into the Middle East and Asia and possibly into Europe as well. What followed after Homo erectus was Homo heidelbergensis. Now, heidelbergensis doesn't mean anything interesting. That's just where the first fossils were found. But this was the immediate ancestor before modern humans. And it reigned between 200,000 and 800,000 years ago. So now we're talking basically within the last 10 seconds in our 24-hour scale. So very, very recently. Now, an interesting thing which happened to Homo heidelbergensis is that, well, that's also interesting. It had a brain size that's almost what ours was. But the Homo heidelbergensis also split into two different populations. And that split happened sometime between 300 and 600,000 years ago, so 12 to 6 seconds ago. And that split is what led to the subsequent speciation of Homo neanderthalus, the Neanderthal. Now, how did that split happen? It's actually a really interesting story and an interesting example of speciation, which is a critical part of evolution. So here's a map of Africa, except that Africa didn't look exactly like this 700,000 years ago. First of all, none of those names were there, and second of all, none of the borders were there, but more importantly, that Sahara Desert, that arid, dry desert there, wasn't a desert at all. In fact, it was a green grassland, like much of the rest of Africa. And as a result, the habitat of Homo heidelbergensis extended all the way from South Africa into the Middle East. And they roamed quite freely across what is now the Sahara Desert. However, that was during an ice age, which was why the Sahara Desert was green. When the ice age ended, the planet warmed, and that greenery faded to desert. As a result, there were two populations of Homo heidelbergensis which were caught on either side of the desert, just as the two proto-chimpanzee species were caught on either side of the Congolese River. Because these different populations didn't interact for hundreds of thousands of years, they went in their subtly different evolutionary directions. The population of Homo heidelbergensis that was in Europe changed and became the Homo Neanderthal, and the one that was left in Africa became us, Homo sapiens. Now, the range of the Neanderthal, as you can see, was solely in Europe. It wasn't in Africa at all because it couldn't pass that desert, couldn't meet us. It only met us when we actually went up. We managed to traverse through Africa into Europe, and then we encountered the Neanderthals. Now, that must have been kind of a trip. The Neanderthals' cranial capacity was actually larger than ours is. So here's an example of what the Neanderthal skull looks like. That's the one on the right next to the human skull on the left. They were big. They were bigger than us. And you can imagine how scary that was. But somehow we survived, and somehow they didn't. And 35,000 years ago, blink of an eye in evolutionary time, they went extinct, leaving only us. We evolved 200,000 years ago. That's when modern man existed. Homo sapiens, also known as wise man. Finally, we moved out of the cradle of Africa, a small, tiny, small sliver of us, about 70,000 years ago, which is basically 1 second before midnight. Now, for our next lecture, we're going to zoom forward from 60,000 years ago to just 200 years ago, and we'll visit a young man in England named Charles Darwin.